In this video, we're going to be doing a complete review of the Sapphire Radeon Pulse RX 5500 XT 8GB OC card. We're going to be comparing it against the Sapphire Radeon Pulse 5700 and the Sapphire Radeon Nitro 5700 XT OC 8GB card. Now, here we're going to be doing a complete review, frames per second, power consumed, and heat generated. So make sure you stay tuned. Don't forget to click like, subscribe, and the little bell notification. That way you know when I come out videos just like this. Hello, my friends. Today we're gonna be doing a video review on the Sapphire Radeon Pulse RX 5500 XT OC 8GB card. In this video, we're gonna be going over everything, unboxing the card, what's inside, the card itself, the performance of the card, a little tweaking and tuning of the card, and then talking about the card in general. So first off, again, here's the card. We can see the dual fans, the BIOS select switch, the PCIe 8-pin. Yes, it does need to be connected. And you know, the overall look of the card, not to mention the fact that it has one HDMI and three DisplayPort ports or DP ports. All right, so this card is based off of AMD's second gen 7-nanometer process, their RDNA architecture. It has a base clock of 1,540 megahertz, a boost clock of up to 1,845 megahertz, and a game clock of 1,737 megahertz. The card also sports 8 gigs of 256-bit GDDR6 RAM with a 14 gigabits per second effective memory clock speed and 1,408 stream processors. It does feature a dual BIOS support. The dual BIOS support allows you to have a quiet mode that you're gonna get a little less performance, but it is going to consume less power. Consuming less power means it's gonna generate a little less heat, allowing it to be a little bit more quiet. And then we have the performance mode, which is what I'll be testing here in the review. All right, so we can see here the card measures 9.17 inches in length, 4.80 inches in depth, and 1.55 inches in width. So it will take up a single PCIe slot, but because it is a dual wide card, it will take up two PCIe slots in the back of your system. All right, so this is how it looks like inside of the system. And then in the video right up here, we'll see the installation. In case you guys don't know how to install it, you can always click on that video and check it out. So in my description below and in my pinned comment, you'll see the specifications of my entire system. That way you guys can know what I'm using to bench this card. All right, so in this review, we're gonna be going over a little bit condensed over my complete review, that way to make it a quicker video for you guys. So we're gonna be comparing the 5700 XT, the 5700 Pulse, and the 5500 Pulse XT. So we can see on 3DMark Firestrike 1.1, we got an overall score of 22,809 on the 5700 XT Nitro. On the Pulse 5700, we have an overall score of 20,214, while on the Pulse 5500 XT, we came in at 12,432. Now the temperatures came in at 58 degrees Celsius on the 5700 XT with a max wattage consumed of 423 and an average of 335. On the 5700 Pulse, we had 65 degrees with a peak of 297 wattage consumed and 246 watts on average. While on the 5500 XT, we reached up to 61 degrees Celsius, 253 watts max and 166 watts on average. Now, going with that, we can see where the price structure comes into play, where it makes a little bit more sense on what the price is per card. So on the Nitro RX 5700 XT, at the time of this review, was $465.42 on Amazon. The Sapphire Pulse 5700 XT was $409.99, while the Pulse RX 5500 XT came in at $229.99. Okay, so on TimeSpy, on the Nitro 5700 XT, we can see we scored an overall of 9,251, consuming 360 watts max and 343 watts on average, heating up the card to 60 degrees. Now on the Pulse 5700, we can see we scored 8,116, heating up the card to 66 degrees with max consumed wattage of 327 watts and on average consumed 234 watts. Now here we can see the Nitro and the Pulse 5700, there was a 13.07% difference in performance. Now, a much larger gap was between the 5700 and the 5500 XT, coming in at 44.77% difference. Now, pulling away from synthetics, we're going to jump into gaming. And one thing that I want to mention, all these games are set on Ultra. All right, so on Metro Exodus, we can see the Nitro 5700 XT came in at 70.74 frames per second at 85 degrees, the highest point. On average, the card consumed 364 watts. Now, the Pulse 5700 came in just below it at 62.88 frames per second and consuming on average 275 watts at 68 degrees Celsius. The Pulse 5500 XT came in at 37.31 frames per second at 66 degrees with an average power consumed of 248 watts. Now, because this is a budget card, I also threw in highs. So on high, the 5500 XT came in at 45 frames per second, 45.55 frames per second, heating up the card to 72 degrees, consuming on average 226 watts. Jumping over to Shadow of the Tomb Raider, we can see the Nitro 5700 XT came up to 121 frames per second, heating up the card to 87 degrees max, consuming 375 watts on average. While the Pulse 5700 came in at an incredibly decent 103 frames per second, heating up the card to 72 degrees Celsius, on average consuming 270 watts. The Pulse 5500 XT came in still at an incredibly playable 64 frames per second, heating up the card below everything else at 66 degrees and consuming 223 watts on average. Now the Pulse 5500 XT on high came in at 75 frames per second, heating up the card a little bit more than the base clock at 77 degrees Celsius, consuming 197 watts on average. So we can see here, not only on high, but on its base clock, the 5500 XT was able to keep up, not surpass, but still able to keep on the at least 60 frames per second magic spot. So now let's jump over to Assassin's Creed Odyssey. On Assassin's Creed Odyssey, we can see the Nitro 5700 XT came in at 88 degrees Celsius at 77 frames per second, consuming on average 376 watts. The Pulse 5700 came in at 66 degrees at 65 frames per second, consuming 288 watts on average. Now the Pulse showed its colors on this one, again, a budget card, coming in at 42 frames per second, heating up the card to 61 degrees, just below everything else, and consuming 230 watts on average. Now, on high, the 5500 XT came in at 70 degrees Celsius at 67 frames per second, very playable over the base clocks, and consuming 235 watts on average. So we can see here the budget card is playing a lot better on high, as you would expect, but I definitely want to show you that here because on my previous reviews, I would only show you Ultra even on the budget card. So I felt that that was kind of taken away from the budget overall. Now on Far Cry 5, we can see the 5700 XT Nitro consumed 301 watts on average, heating up the card to 84 degrees Celsius. Now it did come in at 131 frames per second. The Pulse 5700 heated up to 65 degrees Celsius, coming in at 120 frames per second and consuming on average 292 watts. The Pulse 5500 XT came in at 82 frames per second, incredibly decent for this card, heating up to 72 degrees
at 246 watts on average. Now on high, the 5500 XT came in at 88 frames per second, only a little bit above ultra, heating up the card to 75 degrees Celsius on average, consuming 246 watts. So the card was able to hold its own in Far Cry 5. So let's jump over to Tom Clancy's Ghost Recon Wildlands. Now in Wildlands, we can see the 5700 XT came up to 73.86 frames per second, heating up the card to only 64 degrees while consuming 272 watts on average. The Pulse 5700 came in at 82 degrees at 65.57 frames per second, consuming on average 362 watts. The Pulse 5500 XT came in way behind at 40.29 frames per second, consuming on average 216 watts and heating up the card to 70 degrees Celsius. Now, on high, the 5500 XT came in at 70 degrees Celsius, just like the base clock, but at 72.50 frames per second, consuming on average 226 watts. I did mention I was gonna tweak and tune a little bit. So we can see here, the GPU clock at 1,718 megahertz, while the memory clock was at 1,750 megahertz, and the boost clock 1,845 megahertz. Now, overclocking the card a little bit, it might seem a little counterproductive, but the GPU clock was at 1,245 megahertz. Don't freak out. The memory clock was at 1,860 megahertz, while the overall boost was increased to 1,990 megahertz. Now, we didn't just overclock the card. All right, and on here we can see the overclocks within AMD's latest driver, which a lot of you are freaking out that the driver is horrible, all this and that. I never had any issues. Now, I never had any issues because I did use DDU before to get rid of any and all drivers, reboot, and then reinstall the latest and greatest driver. And I'll go ahead and link up here so you guys can check it out. Now, comparing with the overclock, the base clock, I also compare with Trix. Trix Boost is Sapphire's latest and greatest software to get that extra performance out of your card without the need of overclocking. So in this video, I went ahead and showed you what I did with Trix Boost, how it works. Now we're gonna go talk about it. So we can see here in Metro Exodus, the Pulse 5500 XT base score was 37.31 frames per second, coming in at 66 Celsius, and on average consuming 248 watts. Now overclocked, we can see it did come up at 39.49 frames per second, 76 degrees Celsius, and 232 watts on average. So the power consumption actually, oddly enough, came down a little bit. Now, with Trix Boost, we were able to get the frames per second up to 42.04 frames per second, heating up the card to just 1 degree over the overclock at 77 degrees Celsius and consuming 230 watts on average. That's 2 watts lower than the overclock. So on Shadow of the Tomb Raider, we can see the 5500 XT scored 64 frames per second, consuming 223 watts on average and heating up the card to 66 degrees Celsius. Overclocked, we can see the card heated up to 81 degrees, but did come in at 68 frames per second, only 4 frames per second higher than the base clock, consuming 223 watts on average, the same as the base clock. Coming over to Trix Boost, we can see the card jumped up majorly to 77 frames per second. Now, all of this is base clock using Trix, consuming 207 watts on average and heating up the card to only 65 degrees. That's below overclock and below base score. So that's pretty nice. Now, on Assassin's Creed Odyssey, we can see the 5500 XT base came in at 42 frames per second, not playable at all, consuming 230 watts on average, heating up the card to 61 degrees. Overclocked, while we didn't improve a whole lot, we came in at 50 frames per second, heating up the card to 75 degrees Celsius and 233 watts on average. With Trix Boost, we can see it jumped up another 2 frames per second over the overclock at 52 frames per second, heating up the card to 63 degrees, only 2 degrees higher than the base clock and consuming 242 watts on average, higher than the base and the overclock. Now on Far Cry 5, The 5500 XT base came in at 82 frames per second, heating up the card to 72 degrees Celsius, and on average consuming 246 watts. Now, on the overclock, we did improve a little bit at 87 frames per second, 5 frames more, at 242 watts on average, heating up the card to 80 degrees. With Trix Boost, we were able to come up to an impressive 100 frames per second, consuming on average 258 watts, higher than the rest, at 76 degrees Celsius. On Wildlands, we can see the Pulse 5500 XT base came in at 40.29 frames per second, heating up the card to 70 degrees Celsius, on average consuming 226 watts, while the 5500 XT OC came in at 42.92 frames per second, at 227 watts on average, heating up the card to 72 degrees, while the 5500 XT with Trix Boost came in a little bit more playable, but still way in the back, at 45.87 frames per second, consuming on average 223 watts, heating up the card to 74 degrees Celsius. All right, so all of these are just benchmarks, synthetic and some real benchmarks, but you guys want to see overall gameplay. And in this video, I show you that. I show you playing on medium at 1920 by 1080, Assassin's Creed Odyssey, Metro Exodus, Shadow of the Tomb Raider, Tom Clancy's The Division 2, Tom Clancy's Ghost Recon Wildlands, and Red Dead Redemption 2. So the reason I did medium on this is while high did work perfectly fine, on games like Metro Exodus and Assassin's Creed Odyssey, it did come up well below. So what I did was I brought everything down to medium, that way to keep everything a little bit more consistent, and you can see how well it did here. So comparing the 5700 XT, the 5700 Pulse, and the 5500 Pulse, we can see that the price to performance actually does come around pretty well. Actually, it seems the Pulse 5700 is a little bit more expensive than it should be, but overall, the pricing structure is good. Now, should you upgrade if you, let's say, have a 580 or a 590? Probably not. The 590 is gonna score a little bit higher. The 580 might score a little bit higher too, though you do get GDDR6 and newer technologies on the 5500 XT. You kinda have to weigh your pro and cons on here. Now, below that, let's say like RX 570, this would be a great upgrade option if you don't want to spend the extra money. And on the Nvidia side, maybe an upgrade from a 1050 Ti or a 770. Now, should you upgrade it for the 770 or the 1050 Ti? Probably not. Maybe if you had older than that, definitely upgrade it. So again, this is a good budget card, but if you're looking for extreme performance, you might want to stick to a 5700 or a 5700 XT. They're going to cost you a little bit more, but you're going to get a lot more out of it. For this card, you're going to be able to game at 1920 by 1080 at medium or high, whereas the 5700 and the 5700 XT, you can actually game at 2K, so that is pretty nice there. So I think it's a good buy if you're coming from older technology. Slightly newer technology, probably not. So let me know what you guys think down in the comments below. If you were interested in buying this card before, are you still interested in it now? Or would you hold off a little bit for the next latest and greatest card? All right, guys, Iggy out. See you guys.